Welcome back to Tea Time, our Bible study. I hope you're all doing well. I hope you had a good experience in reading Luke this week. And remember, if you have any questions, please contact me at mark.himmel@peopleofgrace.org. Well, let's begin today with our prayer. Lord, we pray for all those who are in this frontline pandemic challenge we have and with this virus. All of our police and our fire and all the people in hospitals and all the people feeding people and all the people trying to get back to work that they so desperately need to continue their lives. Please be with all of them as they try to help themselves and try to help each other. Keep them strong and keep their families safe. Amen. Well, now for our weekly reading. Our reading, for those of you that may have just been joining us, is to remind us of why we're going through the Bible study, and it's Romans 12:2. Do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Amen. Well, this week for the book of John, written in 80 to 90 AD, covering the time period of 7 BC to 26 BC. The Gospel of John is the fourth of the four Gospels. In John's background, the person John, he was considered to be the closest to the heart of Jesus. He and his brother James were among the first disciples who Jesus told to follow him. They were the sons of Zebedee, Zebedee was a successful fisherman. He owned a fishing business in Galilee. And during Jesus' ministry, John, James, and Simon Peter were the only disciples privileged enough to watch many of Jesus' miracles because they spent so much time with Jesus. Miracles such as the raising of the 12-year-old daughter of Jairus, for an example. Upon Jesus' death, John was told to look after Jesus' mother Mary, as if she were his own mother. It's a strong indication of how very close John was to Jesus and his entire family. At the time of resurrection, John and Peter were two that ran to the tomb to see if the story of Mary Magdalene, who told them, to see if that story was true. She had seen the risen Lord. And John was the first to enter the empty tomb. John was younger than the other disciples. Historians think maybe even a teenager at some degree. He lived to be older than any of the other disciples and was the only disciple not to die a martyr's death. That's interesting and worth studying more about. John continued to write while he was imprisoned on the island of Patmos. Historians thought he wrote Revelations on the Isle of Patmos. They're not sure if he was released or if he escaped from the island, but in either case, he died a few years later, a free man, which we said he was the only one that was able to do that after his imprisonment. Famous stories. Jesus turning water into wine, the raising of Lazarus from the dead. All of these I know you're probably mostly familiar with. And the seven famous I am statements of Jesus. That is when he said, I am the door of the sheep. That would be something good to dig into and see more of the meanings around them. And keep in mind, since there were so many stories and in the Bible and, like raising Lazarus from the dead and turning water into wine, these miracles, just keep remembering that these were done not to show how great or magnificent or any of that Jesus was, but it was just to remind us of how great our Father is, our God is, and that He could do anything. Most famous verses. I'm going to spend a little time on this one, John 3:16. I'm going to unpack it. We haven't done that in a few weeks before, but I think I may going forward. Not all of them, but just pick one each week and unpack it. And particularly John 3:16 about God's gift of salvation. It's just really deep and meaningful and such at the core of our faith, as you'll see as we go through it. So John 3:16 reads, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." So let's cover each one of these pieces of this scripture. The first piece, "For God so loved the world," has been long celebrated as a powerful declaration of the gospel. Very succinct. God did not wait for the world to turn to Him before He loved the world. He loved and gave His only begotten Son to the world when it was still the unloving, disorderly world. To me, when you think about that, God had to have a lot of hope and a lot of faith in the long term that man would eventually love one another and do the right things. And it's we're not there yet, right? Then we go on in the scripture, "He gave His only begotten Son." This describes both the expression and the gift of God's love. God's love didn't just feel for the plight of the fallen world, but God did something about it. He responded. He reacted. He gave the most precious thing He could have ever given, His only begotten Son. And the term begotten, so when you're reading these, and it's as an example, and it's important when you're reading the Bible, if you get a word you don't understand, look it up. It's so easy today to do that. Just get to your Google and look it up. But begotten means fathered. And there's such a deep meaning here that His only begotten Son, meaning fathered by God. And you think about that, that covers such a wide part of our beliefs, and it's a foundational piece. So fathered by God is huge. It's huge. So begotten means fathered by. Just a good example of if you pass up words, there's such deep meanings in one word in the context of how it's being used in the Bible that you really do miss a lot. Then we go on in the scripture, "Whoever believes in Him." This declares the recipient of God's love. Who's receiving God's love? God loves the world, right? But the world doesn't receive His love until we believe in Jesus, the divine Jesus, the gift that comes from God, the Father. Jesus is a gift given to us. And the term "believes in" means more than an intellectual awareness or an agreement with, like we agree with or we understand. It means that we trust and we rely on and we cling to. So it's not just understanding or agreeing when we say the word "believes in" related to God. Then we go on and "should not perish." This describes the intention of God's love. God's love actually saves man from eternal destruction, right? So if there's salvation and God is our Savior and we have an eternal place to go, through Jesus, we're being saved through eternal destruction. God looks at fallen humanity, and He does not want humanity to perish. So He loves all. So in His love, He extends the gift of salvation in Jesus Christ. Then we get to the term in the scripture, "but have everlasting life." This describes a time period, the duration of God's love. The love we receive among people may fade from other humans, but God's love never changes and is never ending. God will never stop loving His people. even to the furthest distances of eternity. So even after our death. What a beautiful scripture, right? John 3:16, and how beautiful it is to unpack it and to really think through it and really cover the details, like I said, of certain words and their context. Important things about this book of John. John wanted to make sure that the people knew that Jesus was not just a great prophet, a miracle man, or a teacher. He was the only begotten Son of God. Back to the begotten, meaning fathered by God, the real Son of God. Jesus was different than we are. We were born of humanity, right? And Jesus was born of God. So important here in John, that message over and over. John did not tell the story of Jesus' birth. Instead, he reached back into eternity. Here's what he started with when he started the gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This statement that I just read had the early church moving to recognize the Trinity, the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Okay, well, that's John. We've come to an end today. Remember to send questions by email if you have any. As you read John this week, or if you had any from Luke of last week. And please remember, those questions are so important, and I would really look forward to them so we can continue to dig deeper into God's Word. Next week, we're going to review Acts. And in the book of Acts, it tells us how the church was born, starting in Jerusalem and spreading throughout the entire Roman Empire. So, that'll be fun too. So stay safe. See you next week. And remember, God loves you, so pass it along. Amen.